hear you are crying, you're so scared and all alone. Hangman is coming down from the gallows and I don't have very long.
Hello and welcome to episode 3 of the self-pity podcast. No, only joking. It's the UK Steelers podcast and I'm joined by my two pals in pity, Dave and Gavin. How are you doing, guys?
Hey, guys.
Not too bad.
Like I say, a lot of self-pity to go around this week. If we'd have recorded this podcast on Sunday night, I might have been inconsolable, but I'm actually feeling a little bit more upbeat today. How about you guys? How are you feeling about the general state of things?
About the same. Like you say, it was quite depressing being down, nothing in week two, but it's a much brighter situation now, I think.
Yeah, with a bit of reflection. Yeah. Gavin, how are you feeling?
Yeah, the game feels like it was a long time ago now.
Yeah, it does. So much has happened since.
Doesn't it?
Yeah.
It feels like it was in a different era of the Steelers.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm actually glad that we waited so long to record the podcast.
Yeah. It would have been like savagely out of date.
Yeah, absolutely. So what we're going to do today, we're going to do things a little bit differently. We're going to start with sort of the big news today, just because there's so much that we want to talk about off the top that we can't really ignore until halfway through the podcast. And then we'll get into a little bit about the Seahawks game and obviously go on to talk about the 49ers that we have next week as well. So unavoidably, I think the biggest news of the day, or you might argue with me about that, is probably Big Ben being out for the season. Obviously, our starting quarterback down for the rest of the season. He's been placed on injured reserve. Not a Tommy John injury, which was something I'd never heard of. I don't know about you guys.
Never heard of it. It beats out the Lisfranc and all the dropping foot or whatever it is.
This was a new one for me, but it was originally feared that it was a Tommy John injury, which is apparently something similar to what Bradshaw eventually went down with when he had to retire. But apparently,
yeah, they did mention that in the game, didn't they?
I think that's where I heard it.
The elbow,
It was kind of eerily similar, actually. But yeah, so it's not as bad as originally feared, but it is going to require surgery, so he is going to be out for the season. But he hopes to be back for next season, doesn't have any plans to retire, he said in a release statement yesterday. Obviously, we'll talk a little bit more about Mason Rudolph and you know, specifically his performance in the game when he came in relief of Ben on Sunday. But just from a sort of a more high-level perspective, Gavin, sort of what does this mean for the Steelers and how are we feeling about Mason Rudolph going forward for the rest of this season?
Well, I've got to say I'm quite excited. I mean, obviously this season's probably a write-off, and if anything does happen, it's a massive bonus. But it does feel like a new era to me, and it's a chance to see what this guy can do. Who, as you say, we're not going to talk too much straight away, but he came out of the box flying, I thought, and looked exciting.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, when you say it's the season's a write-off, I think that was my initial reaction as well. And I suppose what you mean by that, just to clarify, is probably that we're not going to be a Super Bowl contender.
Or expectations will be lowered. So yeah. Anything that does happen that is good will be a bonus.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, I don't see us as a Super Bowl contender, but the question was there of whether you thought that in the first place, given the way that we were playing. Obviously, anything could change after week two. But I, like you say, after sort of sitting down and taking some time to go over the game that I watched yesterday and think about things, I was a lot more confident in what I saw and going forward and really just having the feeling to sort of, you know, how's Mason going to perform for the rest of this year? And it lets us assess that going into the draft this year and obviously in 2021 as well. In terms of the quarterbacks behind Mason, obviously we've brought up Devlin Hodges from the practice squad. And in a shocking move, we've signed Paxton Lynch as our QB3 to the practice squad. Dave, any thoughts on Mason or the backup QBs now going forward?
I think bringing Lynch, it's just another practice squad body, isn't it, really? I don't think he's there to really do anything. Just sort of a safety option in case anything really goes wrong this season. Not that anything can go any worse.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I don't think he's there for any real reason other than just being a body.
Yeah, I mean, it's a bit like picking up a lottery ticket you find on the street, isn't it? That you don't know whether it's rubbish or if it's, you know, in the one in 1,000, one in 14 million chance that it's a winner. That's how it feels to me. Like he's, you know, he obviously had that first round pedigree. They obviously, there was enough there on tape from his college days for him to be a successful quarterback, and he's just not put it together. So it was an opportunity for him to work with a different, another, I think it's his third staff, isn't it? See if he can actually harness that ability that he obviously had, or potential. I mean, he was a very raw prospect. Yeah. I don't know. I think it's a good move.
Yeah, I'd rather have him sitting there than, you know, some of the other. I mean, there wasn't a great deal available, you know, obviously, as we talk about third string quarterbacks, and, you know, especially with the other QBs that have gone down this week and in the last couple of weeks, it's a thin market. But I think of all the options out there, you know, I'm glad we've got someone who's played some games, at least has some element of a veteran presence. Devlin Hodges, I'm glad that he's, you know, made it to the full squad, even though it's through injury, and I think he knows the offense well as well. So, and Ben's still there, you know. Ben's going to be helping Mason all through the year, and he said as much, you know. So I think he's, and especially because this isn't someone competing for Ben's job now. This is literally a time for Ben to prove his leadership, like he's talked about wanting to do. So I actually think the situation's a good one, or about as good as you could hope after Ben going down.
Yeah.
Moving on, because like I say, we'll talk a bit more about Mason Rudolph a little bit later. The other piece of really, really big news this week is that against all the odds, seemingly, Kevin Colbert must have been abducted by aliens and swapped out for someone else, because he's traded for Minkah Fitzpatrick, obviously put on the trade block a couple of days ago before this happened, by the Dolphins, who are now in just complete and utter tank mode. They've gotten rid of pretty much every talented player I can think of on that roster. So we've traded our first round pick in 2020, along with swapping a couple of later round picks with the Dolphins as well. In terms of the value with this trade, Dave, Gavin, how do you kind of feel about this?
I mean, it can only help, really. I mean, Edmonds, despite, I mean, I was looking at some stats earlier, of particularly of the defense, and Edmonds, he had 11 tackles and 8 solo tackles, which sounds pretty good, but he looked pretty lost out there at times. So that extra help out there for him, it can only really, you know, help shore things up, really.
Yeah, I mean, in terms of the value of the trade, it's quite scary not having a first-round pick, I think. And we've not had one since... That's the first time the Steelers have not had a first-round pick since 1967.
Yep.
I'm just thinking, what's it going to be like on draft night? You're sitting there, you're waiting that whole... You know, it doesn't give them anywhere to go, according, you know, depending on how this season goes. And it shows that they have got faith in Mason Rudolph, because they're obviously not thinking about taking a quarterback in the first round next year. So... I don't know. It feels like a big price, but I like the player. So it comes down to the value, comes down to how he plays, as always.
Absolutely, yeah. I think if you were kind of taking a look on the Twitter feed before this happened, obviously the Steelers were one of the teams that were in for Minkah Fitzpatrick. I didn't believe that it would actually happen, but obviously I was talking about it a little bit with people online. And I was all in on this. As soon as I heard that Miami were really just kind of looking for a first-round pick, I was absolutely all in on giving up the 2020 first-round pick for Minkah, because I think what you've got there is a guy, you know, he's only played his rookie year, so he's still got 4 years theoretically left if you take up the fifth year option on him on a cheap price. He's, you know, he's a next level playmaker. He's a guy who was picked 11th overall, but has also proven that he can do it in the league. Obviously, the value has gone down a little bit since then, because you would imagine that with Ben going down, that the pick that we've traded away is actually of, you know, probably significantly higher value, you would imagine. It's likely to be one of the higher picks that we've had in a long time. But at the same time, if you look at our history of first-round picks, you know, just going back the last, you know, few years, you know, Terrell Edmonds, you know...
Jarvis Jones,
yeah, if you want to go that far back. It's been about 50-50 a lot of the time. Obviously, you've got your TJ Watts and your Ryan Shazier's, but on the other hand, you've got quite a lot of guys who, you know, if not busts, at least didn't live up to that first round hype or grade that we had on them. So... to me, to trade away a pick like this for a known quantity who, you know, you've only missed out on 1 year of the rookie deal, and for me, you know, he's a next-level playmaker, similar to kind of like Jamal Adams or one of these guys. I'm really excited about the prospect of having a guy like that in a position that we really desperately needed it.
Yeah, definitely. I think it opens up the playbook as well. It's quite interesting tactically, because I think it'll enable them to roll the coverage. You know, like how some teams, and the Steelers have not been able to do this, where the safety will roll over to the cornerback and the cornerback will roll back to the safety position, so sort of hide what they're doing. So whether they're playing a one or two high safety.
Yep.
And that's something that really confuses quarterbacks, and we've not really had the players to do that. So his versatility and some of that, like Nelson and Hayden, and especially Terrell Edmonds, having those back there as a four, I think that's quite a strong unit.
Absolutely.
Now.
Yeah, versatility is the key word there, because I think the way we've looked with Sean Davis and Edmonds just kind of stuck back there, it's almost been stiff, hasn't it? And that we've just been taken advantage of in certain situations where, you know, they've changed the looks up a little bit, or they've ran across the middle and confused our linebackers, and it's left us sort of stuck. And I, like you say, I think that's exactly right. The versatility he brings is going to be really interesting.
Yeah, I mean, is it a direct response to what Brady did? He just totally picked apart the defense. He knew exactly what was happening. So, you know, this, as I say, this will help to disguise what the plan is.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, obviously things improved a little bit this week, but there was still major mistakes on the back end. So, yeah, this is something we've needed for a while, in my opinion.
And he's, sorry, go on, Doug.
Yeah, so just to resonate quickly, the thought's going out of my head now. No, I've just thought about it. No, it's gone. Carry on.
I was just going to say, you know, and also the other thing he brings is the ball skills, the interceptions, which the Steelers haven't had. And that's exciting.
Yeah, I heard yesterday we've had 4 interceptions. You might have heard this, Gavin, if you listen to a terrible podcast. 4 interceptions in the last 16 regular season games.
Yeah, shocking.
Which is just, which, you know, actually brings me to a good point. We had a message come in this week, as we like, from our listeners. Mike Dandy, who you probably know, you know, in and around the Facebook page, he got into contact with me to talk about the turnover differential. I was going to kind of bring it up as a topic later, but it kind of fits in here a little bit. Talking about the interceptions and what Minkah brings, I thought kind of fit quite nicely into what Mike had sent me earlier in the week, in that he thought that that was maybe the key, whereas last week we talked about penalties and the differential we have and the way that we kind of rank amongst the NFL in penalties. He kind of felt that turnover differential and our lack of ability to, you know, win the turnover battle, or at least make a sizable impact on the back end in terms of interceptions, was costing us games. If I just look at some of the stats, I'm just going to pull those up now, but in terms of Minkah's impact, do you think that's going to be significant? Do you think that that's going to sort of lead to us winning the turnover battle a lot more?
Definitely, and not just him as well. I think Steven Nelson has shown his ball skills as well. I don't know if you noticed some of the plays he made against the Seahawks. You could see that we have not just targeting the ball in the air and disrupting passes. Even if you're not getting picks, they're showing more ability than there's been back there for a while. So I'm feeling confident there's going to be a few more interceptions with this unit.
Yeah, absolutely.
Just trying to think back on interceptions. I can only really remember off the top of my head, maybe Joe Hayden, Edmonds coming down with a couple of picks. That's about it.
Yeah, they played this game on the Tower podcast, actually, where they were trying to remember what the interceptions were, because there's so few and far between that it's hard to cast your memory back.
Not being funny, the last one I can remember is by Troy, I think.
It's definitely not been that long. but if you look at the turnover differential and what Mike did, he actually made the point. I'll read his message out, actually. So shout out, Mike. Sending you this because he loves his stats. Something to consider on the podcast. And narks me the way that punting does mark me, but to be fair to Jordan Berry, actually he did a good job this week, I'll give him that. Our turnover ratio has killed us for the last decade, and here's a comparison to the Patriots that brings it home, league ranking in brackets, which he's provided for me there. I think comparing to the Patriots is always a little bit cheating, because the Patriots tend to be the best in these kind of categories because of the coaching, but it's a fair point. So in 2018, so last year, we had a turnover differential of +1, New England were +10. In 2017, it was +2, New England +6. 2016, it was +5 with New England +12. And then as you go further and further back, it actually does get worse. And I pointed this out to Mike. I said, we have got a little bit better on this. Back in 2011 and 2012, we were at the -13 and -10 level, for example. But, you know, he rightly said that as a team that is competing for the playoffs and for the Super Bowl in all of those years, and the fact that, you know, the cliche is turnovers win games, you would imagine that, you know, turnovers would be high on the list of things you would assume would be important for a team that's competing for a Super Bowl. So is that the key thing that stopped us from reaching our potential over the last few years, do you think?
I don't think it's the key. You can plan for it to an extent and train to it for an extent, but to me it always seems to be a sort of matter of a bit of dumb luck coming into it, really. Just be in that right position at the right moment. Maybe there is some training.
I think to a certain point, but you can't ignore the fact that, you know, we haven't generated interceptions for the last 2 or 3 seasons. I get what you're saying. Interceptions do deal with a lot of luck. But we also don't generate them, whether that's schematically or you know, dropped interceptions, whatever it might be. I think there has to be reasons over a longer period of time that we're not seeing that.
I think it's partly due to the sort of leftover of the Dick LeBeau kind of containment defense, where you try and prevent big gains of the offense, and therefore you're not going to risk making a big play on the ball, apart from Troy, who is obviously freelancing, willing to take a risk at any time. So it's partly that, and I think it's, you know, this defense has been transitioning away from that for 3-4 years now, and it's starting to look, I thought it's starting to come together a little bit, and it's starting to take shape as being its own identity. And I think part of that is bringing in these players with better ball skills, as I was saying earlier, and trying to get those turnovers. So hopefully it will be something that improves.
Yeah, absolutely.
My point's just come back to me. It's come back into my brain. Not to bang on about the Butler bash, you know, bash Butler train. But I might be wrong in this figure. It's a figure that I've read somewhere. I think someone even might have commented it on the Facebook group, that we have 10 first and second round picks in the defense at the moment.
Yep, another one coming in.
If he can't do it with this, what can he do it with?
Exactly. And it's also, it speaks to the fact that they can't really draft, they've not been able to draft defensive backs very well.
Yeah.
And the ones that are on the team are all mainly acquired through free agency.
Yeah. And that's why I kind of like this move, because we've let Miami draft for us here and gone and got a proven guy, which, you know.
Yeah. Yeah, and it seems like Tomlin really liked him in the draft process, visited with him twice, even though he knew he could never be able to draft him.
Yeah.
So it's one of those things that the Steelers always go back to players they like to scout. You know, they've scouted and they've liked originally. They don't tend to move for players that they don't like in the draft process.
Last thing on Minkah, do we know his, kind of his status? Do you think he would play immediately? I haven't seen anything about this. Is he someone that would...
Yeah, I've seen it. He's looked to start, especially with Sean Davis down.
So he would be looking to start against the 49ers?
Yeah.
Okay.
They're working with him now to start.
Brilliant. Speaking of Sean Davis, obviously Sean Davis has gone down to IR with a torn labrum. I believe he's expected to miss the rest of the season, although he could be a candidate to return. I don't know if you've seen any more than me on that.
No.
But with Minkah, like you say, it seems like an upgrade really in that position, even though we've had to give up the draft pick. But for right now, it seems like an upgrade. Sean Davis, what's your opinion on Sean Davis? I've been a little bit split over the last couple of years.
I think watching Cameron Kelly made me think he was better than I thought before.
Yeah. But,
I mean, he was kind of hampered, wasn't he? Because he came in and he was sort of played out of position.
Yeah.
I think he's athletic. I think he's trustworthy. I don't think he's got the big playability.
Yeah.
But, will he leave now? He's got 1 year left on his contract. It's, I don't know.
Quite possibly.
And they're not going to pay him, are they?
No. He seems to me like a kind of a league average starter. He was promising at the very start of his career, and he just seems to have tailed off a little bit. He's not terrible, but he will give up a big play.
Does Minkah, though. Minkah gives up big plays as well. I mean, he's not perfect.
Yeah. Yeah, you know, we should probably say that. Yeah, it's easy to get carried away with these kind of big players, but the playmaking ability almost... you don't want to say makes it worth it, but you know, the appeal.
He's got a higher ceiling. Yeah, he's got a higher ceiling, I think.
Yeah,
and the tactical fluidity I was talking about. I think that's a bigger win for the whole defense rather than just, you know, what Minkah's going to bring personally.
Yeah, absolutely. Last sort of big piece of news, unless you guys have anything else, is just generally the injuries leading into the 49ers game. James Conner was probably the other big one with a knee injury. Seems to be going day-to-day on that. As far as I'm aware, he should be playing in the 49ers game, but we'll see how it goes. Jalen Samuels primed to start if he's not ready to be up, but we'll keep an eye on that. Vince William also down with a hamstring. I don't know if you've had any update on this, but this looks like this might leave him out for a little bit of time.
I've not seen how serious that is.
No, it's currently listed as questionable when I was looking today, but from some of the talk that I heard, it sounded a bit more like it might lead him to miss a bit of time. So obviously with Chicolo down as well, we might be looking a little bit light at linebacker, so that's something to keep an eye on as well.
We had Tuzar Skipper.
No, we're not going back to Tuzar again. If I have to have a third podcast with a lengthy Tuzar Skipper discussion, that's it, I'm giving up. Lovely. That's all I've really got for the sort of the big news. Is there anything that I've kind of missed?
Yeah, I was just thinking, did we really talk about Ben enough? Because obviously that's quite major that Ben's gone down, and it's kind of, I was thinking, you know, does that obviously spells the closing of the the Super Bowl window, do you think?
I would suggest. I do think he'll come back next season. I don't think he wants to go out this way, and I think he, assuming, you know, obviously that his elbow allows him to, assuming there's no complications with that, I think he'll want to come back for another season, depending on how Mason plays.
I mean, maybe I'm being overly positive, but it smells to me of when Ben first came in, and it smells to me of when Brady took over from Drew Bledsoe. It just kind of feels like that there's this young kid ready to go, the sort of established starter goes down, everyone thinks the season's over, and then the kid explodes. And in both of those years, you know, they won the Super Bowl very soon after. So I don't know. But what I was thinking about was, if the window's closed, how long is it really closed now, or has it been closed for a while?
I think you'd probably argue it closed with the start of the season with the loss of Antonio Brown, if I was to really put a pin on it.
Or did it close when Shazier went down?
No, I think we could have still competed at without Shazier. I think, obviously, we lost a lot when Shazier went down because we lost a lot of pace in the defence, and the defence has struggled since. But I think the window was open. As long as you had game breakers like Antonio Brown and Le'Veon Bell, I think that window, as we call it, and it's a vague term, but as far as I was concerned, I felt like we were competing.
So then what about when Bell held out that year?
I mean, what you got to remember is that year, you know, we beat the Patriots leading into the playoffs. We should have beat the Saints, but we missed the playoffs because of a bad PI call. So if we beat the Patriots 2 weeks before the playoffs, as far as I'm concerned, we're competing.
Okay. I'm in two minds, really. A part of me is wanting to be sort of downcast, like say that the season's over and all that, and that Ben's ear is over. But at the same time, he's going to be back. But I think a lot of it hinges on, as you say, how well Mason does this season. If he's coming out as the heir apparent and is making huge strides, then will Ben want to come back to, you know, potentially start on the bench? He's not going to come back and be number two, is he?
No, you wouldn't think so. And if he really does make great strides, you know, if this year experiment with Mason really works out, then maybe he doesn't get the option to come back.
Exactly. Yeah.
In which case, I think, yeah, the Super Bowl window probably is closed if he doesn't come back. So it's sort of, yeah, I'm in two minds. I'm trying to decide whether I'm in a sort of a dark mood or a light mood. I don't.
I just don't think we know enough about Mason and about, you got to remember, this is a very young team all of a sudden, both on offense and on defense. The nucleus is very young. And I don't think we know enough about Mason and what it's going to look like to know whether the Super Bowl window will be open next year, 2 years from now.
Yeah.
But to go back to your point, though, Gavin, I think to talk about Ben a little bit more, if this is the last we've seen of him, then it's certainly a sad sight. I mean, as far as I'm concerned, he's all I've ever known at quarterback, me being the youngest of us. I imagine you've got some stories about the good old days, Gavin. But...
Well, I mean, were you watching the year that he was quite injured quite a lot? I mean, this feels very different to that.
Is that the Mike Vick year?
No, not that year. The earlier one, when it was Charlie Batch and Byron Leftwich coming in.
I don't think I was flopping
around, and you never knew which QB was the actual backup and when Ben was going to be back, and it kind of dragged on for ages. And then he eventually came back, but he wasn't right, and it was just a kind of awful season. But this feels very different to that. Yeah. I mean, the fact that it's happened so soon in the season is a positive, because Mason's had that whole preseason. He just came straight in, and it felt like he'd been playing for weeks already.
Yeah,
you know, it's probably the best time to lose your starting quarterback, I think.
Yeah, it gives us some time to recoup, and the schedule gets a little bit lighter now, or at least you hope.
That week 5 game against the Ravens looks a bit intimidating.
It does a little bit, yeah. I've not got my hopes held out for that one, and we've got to face them twice this season. But we also get to play the Bengals twice, so we can't complain.
Yeah,
win some, you lose some.
Perfect. And obviously we'll talk a bit more about Ben if and when we know more. You know, obviously if it turns out Ben retires at the end of the season, I'm sure we'll devote a lot of time to talking about Ben and his legacy and what all that means. But for now, I think it's time to focus on Mason and move forward from here. Moving on then, if we talk a little bit about the Seahawks game, I just want to kind of recap some of the key points, the key plays, and run through the game. Obviously, please let me know if you kind of want to delve deeper into any of the particular plays that may have cost us this game as I go through. It all started similar to last week almost, where the offense couldn't quite get going, but the defense started pretty nicely out the gate, a lot of pressure. from the defensive line. Obviously, all four of our sacks came in the first half.
Yeah, it seemed like at one point I just thought like, every play you've got a Steelers linebacker in the in the backfield.
Yeah, especially in the the first quarter, almost it felt like wow, this is really going the way that we almost spoke about last week about the D line against their O line. You know, it really was seemed like a mismatch, but that quietened down as the game went on. The first kind of big play, because I don't want to sort of spend too long, you know, going into the minutiae of the game. The first sort of big play was when the forced fumble, the first forced fumble that TJ Watt, I believe, knocked out. Sean Davis blocks a guy in the back, nothing to do with the play, just as we were talking about last week, Gavin. Just silly play.
Yeah, it was disappointing.
We were quite lucky, though, that Pete Carroll challenged a defensive PI call in the end zone that was not given to him. We'll come back to that later. And James Conner sort of capitalises on that turnover with a one-yard touchdown drive. So early on in the game, it looked like things were going pretty well. 7-0 up. I was quite positive. I don't know about you guys, just from the kind of the first 7 or 8 minutes of the game.
I don't feel like it had sort of, this was the big turnaround, but it felt like there was definite improvements there. Yeah. Mm.
Later on in the game, of course, for me, the most frustrating play, and I don't know if you guys maybe know a little bit more about this, because I kept rewatching the play and couldn't quite figure out exactly what the problem was, but Dan McCullers gets a costly personal foul penalty on the Seahawks field goal, wiping the 3 points off the board, but eventually leading to seven as they score a touchdown on the next couple of plays. Did you see what this foul was, either of you two?
I mean, I thought it was a massive moment.
Huge
in the game.
4 point play.
To go from a stop. Yeah. Sorry, say again?
Sorry, I was just saying it's a 4 point play straight there.
Yeah, it's huge. Yeah, I mean, stopped them and then they're back in and they're going to score straight away. I mean, it's massive momentum shift to, you know, deflation for the whole team. And I felt sorry for Big Dan because I'm not sure. Did he sort of collapsed on the centre or on the long snapper? Is that what happened?
It was really strange. I watched it over and over again trying to really understand because I thought, has he maybe leaped or done something like that? It just seemed like he kind of slid in between two blockers. Don't know if maybe there was someone I couldn't see or if he landed heavily on a guy. I truly couldn't make out what the foul was specifically for.
I think it's a very specific safety foul.
Yeah,
where
probably.
The long snapper's kind of in a vulnerable position and he's kind of snapped. There must have been some incident where someone got their neck broke or something. So, and it's
as far as I could see, Dan McCullers was lined up sort of to the... If you imagine I'm looking at it from the field goal, he was lined up to the left of the
he was
stopper.
Over.
So yeah, you're quite right. It might have been an issue to do with that, something more specific. But there wasn't any explanation given on the field, unfortunately, which I was kind of hoping there would be. So I didn't really get to really understand that as much as I'd like to have done. But
it's
either
a
way,
quirky world of special teams. Right?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, and I'm no expert on that, as we know from Punting Corner. so yeah, as you say though, a massive play in the game because that. I mean, we lose the game by 2 points ultimately. Not saying we definitely would have won it, would have changed the complexion of the game, I'm sure, but massive
I mean, you can imagine to go through that, to stop them, get the ball back, and then, you know, just the deflation and the anger it would have caused on the whole team.
Yeah, absolutely. Changed the momentum a bit. We then saw the Seahawks march up the field, and this is where, for me, we started to see a bit of the falling out of Devin Bush in this game. Devin Bush did some great things in this game, but he also did some really questionable things, in my opinion. And the first touchdown to Will Dissly from the Seahawks, he just runs right up the seam and scores a touchdown. And to be honest, Devin Bush looks just completely lost. He's two steps behind him on the coverage, almost runs into, I think it was one of the cornerbacks. I couldn't tell exactly who it was, but you could clearly see it was zone coverage and he was just struggling to understand who he should be covering.
Yeah, well, Will Dissly had quite a day, didn't he?
He did indeed,
They just couldn't stop him.
Yeah, and again, not to jump too far ahead, but I think Devin Bush might have had something to do with the second Will Dissly touchdown as well. So any Will Dissly fantasy owners, as Devin Bush to thank for the win this week.
If we go into this season expecting too much from Bush, I get a feeling now we have.
That's a really good question.
It's always going to be growing pains. Always going to be growing pains with a rookie player, right?
Yeah, especially with the middle linebacker. You know, it's the quarterback of the defense. It's a complicated position.
Yeah, I mean, you just hope they bounce back quickly and they don't cost too many games. But it's part of their sort of growing experience, isn't it?
Yeah, absolutely.
I don't think you can put too much blame on him.
If we want this defense to improve quickly, I think he's someone who needs to kind of start to show signs of improvement over the next few weeks.
Yeah.
I wouldn't single him out as being the lead person. To...
Oh, no, absolutely not. I just think that it was bad in the sense that on two of these touchdown plays, he looked lost. He didn't have a terrible game at all. There were other players that I could point at that had worse games. But it's just unfortunate that the two plays that, you know, he looked a bit lost on, unfortunately, led to touchdowns.
I've not watched, to pull back the curtain, I didn't watch the game back. Did it look like it was a tactic, like a mismatch, a scheme kind of situation? Or like, so, because I find that surprising with my hatred of Brian Schottenheimer. Or did it just look like, I mean, Disley's, you know, he's a sort of lumbering, heavy dude, isn't he? I mean, he's not exactly going to be getting away from many people.
That's
yet.
That's the thing. I think what happened, if you watch the play, basically, Devin Bush immediately leaps up with all of his speed and athleticism. He's kind of, you can tell he's supposed to have like a zone coverage to the left of him. He immediately sort of runs, but there's two players. There's a wide receiver that was lined up just to the right of Will Disley, who basically runs a flat route, and then Will Disley kind of runs straight up the seam on a kind of a go route or a fade route. And Devin Bush, just unfortunately, he's a second too late because he reacts straight away to both of them and chooses to follow the guy into the flat for a split second. You almost wouldn't notice it if you didn't rewatch the play. But it leaves him two steps behind Will Disley, and he just waltzes into the end zone, you know, without Devin Bush being able to even contend the catch.
He's caught staring into the backfield, looking into Russell Wilson's eyes, waiting to see where he goes.
Yeah, quite possibly, yeah. Almost as if he was trying to react to the play before it happened.
I mean, I heard a lot of people banging about on Bush before the season started, saying, no, he's too small, his height's going to be an issue. It seems that his inexperience is the main issue at the moment, really.
Yeah, and after the game, you know, a lot of the guys were talking about communication being the issue as well on these kinds of things, and you could see that that's the kind of play that we're talking about, especially with Devin Bush not calling the plays in the defense right now. It was swapping around the defense in terms of who was calling the plays because of injuries. It felt like communication was a major issue on some of these zone plays as well.
Yeah. Well, hopefully, like I say, that's going to be growing pains.
Yeah.
You know, we want that green dot on his helmet as quickly as possible, really.
Yeah, absolutely. Moving on to, we get the ball back. Ben starts to get into a passing rhythm, and that's what's really highlighted the most for the first couple of weeks for me, is that the offense has not been able to get into rhythm. Minus two drives in this game, in my opinion. Again, it was very difficult. We were making it hard on ourselves on third and short and third down. It was very difficult for us to get into rhythm throughout this game. But after this touchdown, we did start to get into a bit of a rhythm. Ben and Juju started to hook up finally, and unfortunately, offensive pass interference was called on Vance, which backed us up, and we had to settle for a field goal. That kind of led us into the half. The first half, obviously, just before the half ends, Ben, I believe, is when that, you know, he goes out, so we don't see a lot of Mason in that half, if anything at all.
But he got his first reception 5 minutes before half time, right?
Mason, no.
Oh no, Ben. There was a first reception for the team.
What do you mean, sorry?
There was no receptions in the first quarter.
Oh, sorry, I see what you mean. Yeah, yeah.
And then there was his first reception of the whole team was 5 minutes before the half, which, I mean, was shocking for the receivers, or was it Ben's accuracy? I don't know. Was his elbow playing up already?
Yeah, quite possibly. There wasn't a lot there. I mean, the running game was working a little bit better than the passing game, but not by a great deal, and Juju hadn't done anything to that point. But I felt like I say, at the start of the... at the end of the second quarter, we did start to get rolling a little bit before Ben had to leave. And Juju eventually starts to rack up some numbers later in the game, becomes the leading receiver. But
Moncrief skews some of those figures, right?
What's that, sorry?
I'm sure Moncrief skews some of those figures a little bit, really.
Well, we're about to get to Moncrief. So basically, the first drive that the Steelers have in the second half, Mason Rudolph starts to get... you're hoping he's about to get into rhythm. We have two sort of poor run plays on this drive, and then he throws a nice pass right on the money to Dante Moncrief, who proceeds to again fail to catch the ball that's thrown perfectly to him. It bounces right off his face into the hands of a Seahawks defender, and poor Mason, who's just come in relief of Ben, God bless him, gets an interception that's nothing to do with him straight away. So welcome to the NFL.
Well, the boo started, didn't they? And I instantly thought, oh no, why, you know, give Mason a chance. Then I realised, oh wait, it was Moncrief. Okay, that's who they're booing.
Yeah, and you can see it in Moncrief's face almost straight away. He kind of, he looks at the intercept, the guy's lying on the floor because he just kind of stayed in bounds, and he looks just completely dejected and shocked that it's happened, and just turns around and walks away. But I believe he was pretty much benched after that point.
It was one target, no receptions, and didn't see the field again.
Which, you know, probably for the best. We'll talk a bit more about that later. But so we kind of move on without Dante Moncrief, and I felt like that was a real shame for Mason, but it didn't seem to knock his confidence.
No, straight back.
Yeah.
Bush, again, when I was talking, I've already spoken a little bit about this, but later, Bush again gives up the touchdown to Disley. Very similar kind of play, to be honest, just a step behind him because he's trying to read the field. Something I think he probably needs to improve on, and just leads to another touchdown up the seam. And then we get the flea flicker, which was a fun play. Mason Rudolph, obviously, nice little handoff to James Conner, who tosses it right back to him. And then just a beautiful throw for 46 yards, straight down to Juju. What did you think of this throw? Was the first real sort of deep ball and opportunity that we'd seen out of Mason?
Well, that's what we've seen from Mason in the preseason as well. Some of his throws are just electric, so exciting, and more accurate than Ben, I think. You know, some of his the whole range of passing as well, short, intermediate, long, he's just got accuracy, just gets it right in the barrel.
Yeah.
It's so encouraging.
On rewatching the game, this is the play. I know it's a flea flicker, so take what you will from that. It messes with the coverages, but this is the throw specifically that excited me. It was right on the money. It was in stride. It was in a tight window that Juju had because the coverage wasn't too bad considering it was a flea flicker. There was a guy right on him. And this was the point where rewatching the game, I was like, right, okay. I'm in on this Mason kid. This might not be all bad.
He's got a rifle. It's like Ben absolutely. Sometimes, Ben's got a cannon. You know, he can get it down the end, but sometimes it will wobble a little bit or kind of fluttery kind of, arc on it, whereas Mason's balls, they just look like a bullet flying there.
Yeah.
And the speed, the speed of the release.
What was that,
Dave? Just getting back to Ben briefly. I feel like maybe this injury has been sort of slowly building on him or something, because it seemed like he was underthrowing, overthrowing, like you say, on those deep balls, overthrowing a lot of the times. So maybe he's putting more into it to compensate for not feeling quite right. I'm speculating here, but
That's exactly what I thought. When the injury came out and that he'd been sort of struggling with it the whole game, I thought, how long has he been struggling with it? Because he's not been right.
Yeah, we heard after the game that he complained about it after the week one game. So, absolutely. Right. It probably was a factor in his throwing. Maybe even at the end of the Patriots game, who knows? Moving on from that, at this point we were 1 point behind in the game. Considering that Mason Rudolph had come in and the disaster of Ben going down, it was competitive. And then we get dealt a real blow, and this is where, when I was watching it in the bar with you, Dave, I felt like it was all lost. When Rashad Penny runs up to the whole D-line and somehow manages to kind of stop and juke the entire D-line and then go the whole way for a long touchdown. I don't know, Gavin, if you remember watching this play, but...
Yeah, definitely. I mean, Chicolo didn't seal the edge, did he?
Exactly.
Chicolo, unfortunately. It was when Watt was off. Watt was getting treatment for something, wasn't he? He had a slight injury for the... And you could see the rush and the whole D really suffered when he was off the field. And Chick, I mean, he's kind of averagely solid player. They like him on special teams, but, he was there just plugging the gap and he didn't do his job on that play, unfortunately. And the one thing, not getting too far ahead, but it doesn't bode well for the San Francisco 49ers that they were getting run on plays like that, because that's exactly what they do with Mostert and Breider. Yeah. That kind of play.
Yeah, that does worry me leading into next week's game. But yeah, like we say, we will get to that, but that is a concern. But Chicolo's out next week, so maybe Watt won't have the chance. But then the question is, who comes in if Watt does need to go out? But
is this the Ola show?
Yeah, let's hope so. Now, the next one that is the most encouraging part of the game for me. Mason leads us on a touchdown drive. His first touchdown drive as a Steeler. This was a very encouraging part of the game because he showed great poise, great accuracy. He showed patience in the pocket in the actual touchdown to Vance McDonald. He kind of drops back, waits for the play to develop, even throws right into the face of some rushers that are right on him. In this drive, we saw a lot of great sort of play action stuff. You know, he turns around away from the defenders and throws it across the middle to James Conner at one point. He even uses his legs to run 7 yards to make a first down on third down. So really kind of versatile offering from Mason Rudolph in this drive. And this is what, again, really sold me on the chance that, you know, maybe he is something special, or at least, you know, someone we can rely on.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. And the key thing you said there was the play action. I think this team's under Ben, it's not used play action a lot, has it? And it's one of the things that can really help you when you're down, or, you know, you need to get some plays behind you. Then it really helps, because it really confuses everyone. And I wonder whether, you know, Ben's not a fan of play action. He likes to keep his eyes on the defense, yeah. I think. But I was thinking, you know, maybe this shows that Fichtner, you know, his play calling's been a bit restricted by Ben, because he is Ben's man. He got the job because Ben wanted him to get the job, and he wanted Todd Haley out the door. So I think Fichtner's perhaps had to be a little bit of a yes man. Whereas suddenly with Mason we saw flea flicker, we saw the play action, we saw all the plays that maybe Ben not so keen on that actually opened up the field for us. And it's encouraging, I think.
Yeah, absolutely. Just the versatility and the difference, and it just felt like that. It's only one drive at the end of the day, you know. But unfortunately, we didn't get to see a great deal more just because of the time and the kind of game that it turned to be in the last few quarters. But yeah, very encouraging from what I saw in that drive. But unfortunately, like I say, straight after this, almost we get the Seahawks drive, which is the big controversy in this game, which is the PI challenge from Pete Carroll. So obviously, just for a bit of background, it's thrown deep. Edmonds is on the coverage. I believe, was it Tyler Lockett who it was thrown to?
I don't know actually.
I think it was Tyler Lockett. I might be wrong, because he was a little agile guy. And he kind of bends his body in midair, Tyler Lockett or perhaps Terrell Edmonds, depending on your point of view, who does it, and fails to make the catch. But even in slow motion, I'll be honest on this one, guys, I was completely unsure about whether this was PI or not. I couldn't decide. I don't know if you've had a chance to go back and look at this, Gav or Dave, but
I didn't see it. I was sitting there chuckling that the Seahawks coach,
Pete Carroll.
I was chuckling that Pete Carroll had wasted his challenge flag. I think there's no way. What's he doing? He's just doing a Mike Tomlin. And then I just almost dropped my beer when they turned it around.
If Mike Tomlin had challenged this, I guarantee it wouldn't have been overturned. Dave, I don't know, like I said, I don't know if you had a chance to watch it. Did you have an opinion on whether this was or was not PI?
I didn't really look back on it. I watched a sort of I watched the highlights, basically. Watched highlights back, the sort of game in 40. I didn't really pay much attention to that. Looking back on watching it live, it didn't really feel like it was. It felt a bit sort of it was just a bit quick.
A bit ticky-tacky.
Yeah.
Was there something earlier in the play? Or is it in the air?
It's the bit in the air. So he basically leaps up for the ball, but it's coming into his chest or his stomach almost. And Terrell Edmonds has got his arms kind of jammed up in there behind him. But again, the kind of movement that he makes is questionable, whether or not he just did it himself or whether Terrell Edmonds really had an impact on the play for me. It's one of those plays where if they'd have called it PI, probably wouldn't have complained that much, but because it was overturned, it turns it into this whole thing, and obviously PI this year is so controversial anyway, and it's got to be obvious to overturn.
Exactly,
it.
I thought it's got to be a major infraction for them to turn it over.
That's the controversy. Not the controversy isn't really whether it was PI or it wasn't, because to me that seems very 50-50. I couldn't tell you, I didn't know the answer, but because I didn't know the answer, should show you that why are we overturning that on a challenge?
Yeah.
So a very questionable decision and a huge decision in the game as well in terms of the way it went, because obviously Metcalf then gets the long touchdown up the sideline. Finally, he wasn't being covered by Steven Nelson, who pretty much kept him in check this whole game.
Another good showing from him.
It was a good showing from Steven Nelson. I was very impressed, but unfortunately, he wasn't being covered by Nelson at this point, and they noticed that, schemed it up and threw it straight on Edmonds, who just never really got his eyes on the ball, never turned around to locate the ball, and even though he was just about on him, he was a step behind maybe, he couldn't quite locate the ball or stop the physicality of Metcalf getting up there to get it.
Yeah. I think that you've hit the three reasons why I thought the Steelers lost the game, and it wasn't because Ben went down. I thought it was early on the receiver core slash Ben not being able to throw a pass on target, then it was a big damn penalty, and then it was this challenge. And those three things just prevented the Steelers from winning the game. Otherwise, I think it was theirs.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think it's kind of encouraging, really, that we lost this game not because of Mason Rudolph, but because, you know, of some strange, either would be it official decisions or foolish fouls or penalties and this, that and the other. It was these are things that theoretically can be corrected or are out of the Steelers' control, rather than it being Mason Rudolph. This definitely isn't, for example, a Luke Falk situation, you know, in New York, where you can't move the ball. The last real, obviously, big moment of the game is when you thought we were back in it. I know I was celebrating as if we'd won in the bar. was the fumble by Chris Carson, really deep in their own half. Fumbles it. It looks like Mike Hilton might have kind of, I don't want to say necessarily forced the fumble, but he got the pressure on there that caused the quick drop. And then I thought this was a really exciting and interesting return by Devin Bush. This kind of redeemed him for me a little bit in this game, where he kind of, at first I'm screaming, I'm like, why are you going backwards? He runs almost, you know, 15 yards backwards and then turns gets the edge and runs right to the 3 yard line.
Yeah, but it nearly resulted in the most disappointing play in the whole game, right? Fumbling into the end zone.
So I was on edge.
Know anything but that.
Yeah, I know, I was on edge. I mean, that's a terrible rule anyway, but yeah. So you know, to cut a long story short, that was a wonderful return, but we got a nice touchdown as well. Mason Rudolph throws his second touchdown to Vance McDonald on a play action. And then the Seahawks, unfortunately, managed to milk the clock. And the last real big play, we give up third and 16 to Russell Wilson and a scramble straight up the middle, which is just unforgivable. And it allows Pete Carroll to milk the clock down on fourth and one.
Yeah, and Brian Schottenheimer, as much as I hate him, he pulled a blinder there. I thought that was the tactical nous of bringing the team out, holding on, seeing what they do, call the timeout, come back. And score, you know, win the game.
Yeah, and it was easy to forget as I went back to rewatch. But that drive, the final drive of the Seahawks, started with 4.5 minutes on the clock. And at that point, you're thinking, we stop them here. You know, in 4.5 minutes, we've got plenty of time. So fair play to the Seahawks. They managed to drive all that time off the board without even getting too close to our end zone.
Yeah, he must have learned a few tricks during his time in the college game because he wasn't doing stuff like that.
We are running a bit long, so I don't want to spend too long.
Just one quick thing. A couple of things I did notice that you didn't mention was the Benny Snell run.
Yes, sorry, yes.
That was
Snell.
Encouraging.
23 yards, wasn't it?
Yeah, 23 yards, and he made someone miss.
Yeah.
It's great.
And that was on, what, a fourth and one? Or
I can't remember game time where it happened, but it was a good play.
It was on either a third and one or a fourth and one, because the line was stacked up. And this is what I actually wrote down in my notes about it, was it might not be a huge deal. Because the way the line was so stacked up, you know, there was no one, there was no middle linebackers almost. They were all blitzing to try and stop the run.
But so he hit the hole. The hole wasn't right in front of him. He diagnosed it and went through and then made the guy miss.
Yeah, that's exactly what I've written here. He found the hole well, he capitalised well. And the reason it was such a long run was because there was nobody there to stop him until the second.
Yeah.
But what I'm saying is, it was a good job to get the fourth and one and then obviously the long run after. So he finishes the game as a third down back for 23 yards on one run. So not a bad average for him.
Football is here, but it's on his way.
Yeah, well, he looks like he might be having more of a role against the 49ers, right?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Especially if James Conner's down.
Yeah, that's what I mean, yeah.
So what I want to do then really is just kind of go over some of the positives and negatives to come out of this game before I sort of jump into anything. Is there any sort of high-level things that you guys want to talk about?
Well, it's a silly thing, mm-hmm. but did you notice Ray Sherman, the unfortunate passing of Daryl Drake, but Ray Sherman was kind of, he was with the team, but he's been promoted to be wide receivers coach. Did you notice him kind of chilling on the bench? He looked like, you give him a beer, it looked like me chilling on the bench, just sitting there watching the game. You see, that really angered me, you know, losing the game. His receiver core is drastically underperformed. He sat on the bench with his arm up like, oh yeah, Sunday football. It's like, come on, why isn't he up there? Why isn't he like drawing up, you know, schemes, plays, trying to motivate some people getting into Moncrief? I mean, Moncrief has gone by that point, but you know, getting onto Switzer, who had another terrible game. I just thought, you know, I don't want this guy to be the coach for long term. That's him over for me.
Are you saying that he did a Jacob Rees-Mogg on the bench?
Almost, yeah. More casual. I mean, a bit cooler, but yeah, it was. I was shouting at the TV.
I'll be honest, that wasn't the kind of the high level point I thought you were going to make there, Gav. But
it's a high level point.
That's the attention
to detail. I do like watching watching the body language of the coaches. You know, I like to see them with all the players huddled around and an iPad or print out and showing some things and getting their backs up, you know, and maybe making them think they're playing for their jobs, not chilling next to them. It's like, oh, good game, guys, isn't it? Who do you think is going to win?
It's not particularly high level, but I'm just really happy to see Vance back involved again.
Yes.
It was so great seeing him back involved. I mean, he wasn't used at all week one, apart from in the fourth quarter. It's just great to see him back. What, had two touchdowns, and I don't know how many receptions.
Seven,
was it?
Yeah, no drops, which is always the way we used to plague him. It doesn't seem to so much anymore.
He's a pivotal role in this offense, I think, at the moment, especially with Moncrief being as he is.
Yeah.
Well,
should Moncrief be playing anymore?
You need to sit him down for a couple of weeks. First of all, make sure the finger's right. Make sure that we fully understand the situation and why, you know, this has happened, and just give him a bit. Even if we have to, you know, do a bit of messing around with the injury report that Mike Tomlin likes to do now and then, you know, sit him down. Let's get him inactive for a couple of weeks, get him sorted, and then see if we can reintroduce him. Because, to be honest, by then I would hope that with Mason, Deontay Johnson, and James Washington have, you know, started to make their way into this team, because we did see that today a little bit. A couple of good catches from both of them on that drive.
Yeah, and also Johnson seemed to have stolen Switzer's return job.
Yes, yeah. Which leaves you questioning, is Switzer, you know, almost on that bubble where he could be the next to go if we need to bring, you know, maybe Eli back in or Eli Rogers?
I know, and that's the kind of the topic of the podcast as well so far. One of the things we keep coming back to is Eli Rogers versus Ryan Switzer. But I think, again, having Ryan Switzer there instead of, you know, Eli Rogers has hurt this team.
Yeah, and he can gain separation. And he was in the building this week, confusingly, that was reported the other day. So I'm not quite sure why he was in the building. Apparently we didn't have any intention of signing him on that day. But you've got to imagine he's still in the area and maybe, I don't
picking
know
picking up
the
his phone
are.
Charger or something.
Yeah.
I have everything crossed. I'm trying to learn how to cross my ears. I can't cross anything else.
I do think this might be one of the things that the fan base is getting a little bit riled up about, though. I don't know that Eli Rogers is the answer to all of our problems, and if he's going to be, you know, the Messiah returning back to the...
He's not the Messiah. I mean, he's a bit part player, really.
Yeah, let's maintain our you know, composure on this Eli Rogers look.
I think his bit is better than the bit that Switzer brings.
Yeah, yeah. At this point, especially without the return value, then I would agree. A couple of the positives then, just before we move on to the 49ers game. I thought that we had a great game from the O-line again. Only allowed 6 pressures and 40 dropbacks, despite the upheaval of obviously having a backup that you're not familiar with in the... Villanueva played a great game against Jadeveon Clowney.
Yeah, didn't really see much of Clowney.
Yeah, exactly. And that's because Villanueva played an awesome game, one of the highest ranked tackles this week per PFF. So a good game from them, and that, I think that'll serve us well against San Francisco's impressive D-line next week. And as well, like I mentioned earlier, the D-line as well. So in the trenches on both sides of the ball, I felt we did well, especially in the first half. Obviously 4 sacks. Tuitt just absolutely dominated in the first half. Constantly in the Russell Wilson's face. So that was really impressive. And then obviously we've already mentioned Steven Nelson, who I thought had a really good game covering up DK Metcalf. And you've jumped me on the Snell thing. That was my last point. So well done, Gavin. You've preempted me.
the Castro, you know, that play as well, where he pulled out and blocked for Samuels. That was a good, I mean, classic the Castro. But it's always enjoyable watching him do that, you know, lay someone out.
Yeah, you sometimes forget about this O-line, but it is a blessing. You know, it's one thing we don't have to worry about with all the confusion around, you know, defensive backs and wide receivers. It's lucky we don't have to worry about the O-line all the time.
Yeah, it's encouraging for Mason. He's going to be able to sit there, and he's showed some good movement as well in the pocket, I thought, Mason.
Yeah,
when he's got the time to move in a noisy pocket, the O-line's going to protect him, and he can sort of, he's got the feet, he can just do that little wiggle that I think, you know, when you talk about QB mobility, sometimes that's better than having someone that's just going to, you know, bomb out of the pocket straight away. They just navigate the pocket. And then get the pass, you know?
Absolutely, yeah. And you know, like I say, he's got the legs. He's not a running quarterback, but he's got the agility, a bit like Ben did early in his career.
Yeah.
Moving on then, obviously, this has been a big week, so apologies that we got a bit long on this one. I'm sure people don't mind. Most podcasts probably do it in 2 separate weeks. But if we look at the 49ers game, Levi Stadium, so we're travelling over to the West Coast this week, 9:25 here in the UK. We take on the San Francisco 49ers, who, shock horror, are 2-0. We're 0-2. Who would have predicted that going into this portion of the season?
Did you hear the stat that they've gone 2-0 in 2 away games, which is the first time they've done that since 1989, when Joe Montana was their quarterback?
Wow, no, I hadn't heard that. That's
crazy.
Yeah. It's been a weird 2-0. They completely dominated the Bengals last week, and obviously it felt like Tampa Bay gifted them the first game. But yeah, I think last week for me, did you watch much of the 49ers-Bengals game, neither of you?
Yeah, I saw a bit.
It felt like it was a bit of a romp, really, considering the way the Bengals played in week one. I thought it was going to be a close game.
Yeah, I mean, it was a run play clinic, I thought. Yeah. You see every single possible run play in Kyle Shanahan's book. I mean, it was entertaining.
It was impressive, yeah.
Two-headed monster with those two. And then you got Juszczyk, doing Juszczyk things.
And considering that they're both undrafted free agents as well, weren't drafted. Raheem Mostert and Matt Breida.
Yeah, I mean, it's not like they're thunder and lightning. They're both kind of both lightning.
Yeah, yeah.
Just proper two-headed monster. You know, they do a drive with one, then the other one spells him, and he brings exactly the same skills. So they don't need to change what they're doing.
Yeah, and that does worry me a bit because we do have a bit of a leaky run D, and especially when you start. I saw a lot of kind of tricky plays and screens and things like that that we tend not to defend.
Yeah,
well.
They seem to have Deebo Samuel in that Tyreek Hill role with all the jet sweeps or gunning down the outside on a go route. So he's one to watch. Then you've got Goodwin on the other side.
Yeah.
So they got speed on the outside and a good run game. So, yeah, it's concerning.
Of the
top four receivers, two of them are running backs. It's a two-headed beast, really. Mm.
George Kittle, obviously, a major mismatch nightmare.
Yeah, after what Disley did as well, is he going to be the Kittle breakout game for this year? Because he's not blown it up this year, and I know that because he's in my fantasy team. I've been waiting for him. I just hope I'm not going to be, he's going to be scoring all the points for me against the Steelers. I hate that.
Well, this last week was kind of crazy with Kittle because he basically was just an extension of the run game. They kept running out wide, and he was just there blocking on every play, and that's why he didn't put up big numbers, but. Seemed to do an effective job at that, so he's clearly a dual threat in that sense, and that's what you want from your tight end. But yeah, it does worry me a little bit. Obviously we'll see with Minkah coming in, but that's a bit concerning in itself that he's not had a lot of time to gel with the team and maybe isn't going to be fully up to scuff with the playbook. We talk about all our miscommunication issues. With fast receivers like Godwin and Deebo Samuel going up against the potential for these hard-nosed runners, these two guys that are both agile but also can run between the tackles, and then you've got to worry about George Kittle across the middle. I must admit, I'm a bit nervous about this game more than I probably was before the season started.
Yeah, I mean... go on, Dave.
No, go ahead.
I was going to say, one thing is their defense, although they've got a terrifying D-line, as you mentioned, and they've got Quan Alexander in the middle, he's a good player... I don't know. They're a bit conservative. They've kind of played. They just rush four most of the time. Play zone behind that. I think there is scope with Mason to just kind of pick him apart a little bit if he gets into his rhythm early.
Yeah, that's what we need. Yeah.
Yeah. Obviously that rush is fearsome. Like, even though they only bring four, they only really need to because they've got such good depth. I mean, you look at their roster. The guy that had the big game. Yeah, was it Blair? Yeah. He's actually their third string left end. I mean, he was a leader in tackles and sacks. And he just got this violent dip and rip move. I don't know if you noticed that. He just kind of blows up the guy from his side and whacks him. And then he's up into the quarterback's face. And that's going to be pretty scary for Mason. But, I mean, he's third string behind Dee Ford and Nick Bosa.
Yeah, the depth on that line is crazy. Because, like you say, Blair is kind of an under the radar name when you've got DeForest Buckner, Armstead, Dee Ford, Solomon Thomas, Nick Bosa, a wild list of, I mean, a lot of them are first round picks. So it's surprising to me that they even traded for Dee Ford. Did they trade or they just signed him in free agency, didn't they? Dee Ford this season. Seems like a luxury, but yeah, definitely. But we match up well with the O-line, so hopefully we can kind of keep them in check.
Yeah. I mentioned their O-line, Staley's down, isn't he? And they've got nobody listed on the depth chart behind him, so that's going to be a bit confusion. I think whether they move their rookie tackle over from the other side, and then that's going to be confusing for him, and then someone's got to come into his place. So that's something that the Steelers might look to exploit.
Right, yeah, absolutely. So it could be a big one for maybe TJ Watt or maybe Bud Dupree can get involved.
Yeah. Or Ola.
I'm going to start banning Tuzar Skipper and Ola talk until one of them makes a play.
Yeah, that's probably very sensible.
Jimmy G is one I just want to talk about quickly. For all the talk of how great the 49ers have been the last two games, I don't feel like we talk about Jimmy G. What's your take on Jimmy Garoppolo?
I don't know. I'm jury's out on him for me. I'm not entirely convinced. He was supposed to be the next heir apparent to Brady, and everyone was, bowing down at his feet, ready to crown him as the next one. And he's not really proved it to anyone, really, yet, I don't think.
Yeah, ravaged by injuries a little bit, but, still waiting for that kind of what we saw in New England in those games where he played in relief of Brady. I think the fact that they've been able to win almost in the Kirk Cousins model without really relying on him to have a major game, obviously. I mean, to be fair, his stat line wasn't too bad. I think it was sort of in the mid 200 yards, whatnot, in the last game, but it was.
I thought he played pretty well.
Yeah, it was a heavy offense game, so you've got to take that into account in terms of the points that they put up, but. It just doesn't seem like he's the focal point, which seems a little bit odd to me, Gavin. I don't know if you disagree.
Is that post-injury? I mean, when he started his first year in 49ers, he was the focal point. Yeah. And he went down, and then it's just coming back slowly, I think.
Yeah.
I think he's a good player.
But that's concerning, because if he does turn out to be what they expected when they, traded for him from the Patriots, all of a sudden you've got all the things we've just talked about, and then, if he's a top 10 quarterback even, that's all of a sudden a very, very dangerous offense.
Well, let's just hope he doesn't have his breakout game against the Steelers.
So our analysis so far is, let's hope George Kittle, Debo Samuel and Jimmy Garoppolo don't have their breakout games against us.
Hey, I think that's why people come to this podcast, is the cutting analysis, right?
That's exactly right. That's what I've been told so far. Lovely. Anything sort of major, anything else we want to talk about the 49ers? Obviously, Richard Sherman, I imagine. Does he still travel with the number one receiver? It might be a tough matchup for Juju.
Yeah, I think he does.
Yeah.
It will be tough. I mean, I'm not expecting... I don't know. Hopefully, Johnson and Washington can step up and have big days and sort of make up for the loss of... what I'm expecting to be the loss of Juju to Sherman.
Yeah, might well be, unfortunately. Don't tend to get one over on Sherman too often, even... as he gets up there in age.
Yeah, I mean, he's one of those players you don't always see very much because quarterbacks just don't throw it
to him. Yeah. But maybe there'll be a bit of kind of rookie, I don't know if you want to call it bravado, but not necessarily the right word, but, in terms of the fact that he maybe won't be thinking in that realm, maybe he'll try and get it in there to Juju being the best receiver on the team early in the game. We'll see.
I think they'll be drilling him not to throw it his way all week.
I think Vance McDonald might be a big one in this game. Obviously, he seems to be a bit of a safety blanket as tight ends off and half for young quarterbacks.
And going back to his old team as well.
What's that, sorry?
And going back to his old team as well.
Oh, so, yeah, of course. Yeah, obviously, yeah. Yeah, yeah, so a bit of a Vance McDonald revenge game we could be in for.
Yeah.
Lovely. Exciting stuff. Exciting stuff. I'm excited for this game.
I am. I do hope... As I said, I really enjoyed watching their run game. So I do hope that it's a good game, that it doesn't just sort of fizzle out and become, like a 10-7 or something.
Yeah.
I do hope there is. I think it would be a good scoring game. I think we need that. We need to see some points go up and be prepared for them to put some points on us too.
Yeah, absolutely. I hope it stays competitive. But it is also at this point, if we want to stay competitive this season, and bear in mind there's no real reason for us to want to tank or get a high draft pick anymore. This is the game we need to go out there and win. There's no point calling any game a must-win game at this point in the season, really, is there? But the statistics show that if we lose three games on the trot, there's a minimal chance that we make the playoffs.
No, it's not a tanking year. I think it's a developmental year.
Exactly. Yeah, that's the right way to put it. The Steelers don't tank. We aren't a complete embarrassment. Dolphins. So yeah. Anything else to add, guys?
No, I think I'm good.
Yeah. Perfect. Now, we normally do topics at the end of the podcast. We have gone a little bit longer. Do you think we've got time for that, Gavin? How are you feeling?
I think a quick one. I think everyone in the group has got one topic, burning topic in their mind, which was, how was the big Steelers meet-up in Manchester?
Well, I'll let the man who drunkenly missed his train and forgot his coat answer that.
Oh, sounds good.
How is my coat, sorry? Well,
I've got a couple of questions on this, actually, because it's hanging on my hallway little coat hanger at the moment. But I must admit, when I took it to put it in my bag when I was, travelling home, because I only brought a backpack with me, it was very, covered in, grass and various things from the ground.
Yeah.
As if you'd decided to kind of just sprung up that morning.
Man of the trees.
Do you live in a hovel, Dave?
Northwich is it's like a Hobbitville. I'm a landscape gardener, so I
explains it.
Things that are of nature. So yeah, that's why it's my work jacket. I grabbed it out of the van before I left, basically.
So you actually do a proper hard working job for Lynn.
Well, I don't know about hard working, but yeah, I do a job. Yeah.
All right. Well, that's quite hard, isn't it? Like digging paths and stuff like that.
No? Yeah, I'm more sort of making comment on my apathy. But yeah, it's hard working in that respect. Sort of, it's physical, I suppose you'd say. Yeah.
Yeah.
I have to be honest as well, Gav, to be fair to Dave, to give him a compliment, and I said it as soon as he walked in, that beard, when you see it on a photo, doesn't do it justice. Perfectly trimmed, very manly, he puts a lot of time into it.
Is it a bit of a Brett Kiesel going on? Or
Not as unwieldy, but also in an impressive way. You know, you can tell that he could let it get out of control if he wanted to, but he's invested a lot of time into making sure that it looks perfect and primed.
Does some oil go onto it?
I would imagine so.
Back in the day. I'll show you some pictures from back in the day. I was a bit of a caveman, so yeah.
So do you want to give a shout out to everyone else that turned up?
You're putting me under pressure now to try and remember if everyone who was there. So I suppose a bit of context for anyone listening and who isn't a member of the group or doesn't know. We had a meetup for some of the kind of, you know, the long-term members of the UK Steelers fan group on Facebook, which is kind of where this podcast sprouted up from. Unfortunately, Gavin wasn't able to make it because he's a dirty southerner. And it was in Manchester at Bunny Jackson's Bar, where the home of the 10p wing, which I quite enjoyed. Surprisingly good for 10p as well. In terms of who was there, Dave, you're going to have to probably help me out here. We had Phil. We had obviously Jason, who runs the group. We had Erin join us, who's from Manchester as well. We had Lee Matthews. You, Dave, myself. Who am I forgetting?
Was there Freddie? Was Freddie there?
Freddie wasn't there. Too southern again, unfortunately.
He was coming. So. What's that, Dave?
He couldn't get his visa to get out of the south.
Ah, right, yeah.
Is that everyone? Have I got everyone, Dave? I'm going to be so feel so bad if I've forgotten someone.
I'm going to be feeling really bad if there was someone we've missed out, but I think that was everyone.
Was it a bit like a sort of weird internet date where you're not quite expecting who you're going to meet up, but then actually when you all got together it was great because you all had a shared passion for something and it all was all fine, no awkwardness?
It was, yeah, to be honest. It was one of those things. I was there first, obviously, because I showed up in Manchester at about 11:45 and nobody else showed up until 5 p.m.
Nice.
So, but I'd booked a hotel and I was nearby, so it was all fine. And I was waiting there and Erin showed up. Who I hadn't really spoke to much before either, because he'd sort of tagged along. He was in Manchester, and you know, he was a great laugh. It was great to have him along, and then obviously everyone sort of trickled in. Jason showed up along with, I think, Lee and you, Dave, in kind of a Reservoir Dogs moment through the door, so that was impressive. But yeah, no, it was great fun. It was good to meet everyone. Everyone was a great laugh and had a good time watching, you know, Phil try the hot wings that are famous in the bar, and watching, you know, Dave obliterate me for drinking dark fruits.
Yeah. Less said about that, better, yeah. Really.
The result wasn't great, and obviously it was one of those things, but we had a great time, even though we kicked a Packers fan out the bar.
Oh, really? That sounds interesting. What happened there?
No, we didn't physically kick him out. He was supposed to be watching the Packers-Vikings game that the bar had told him they were playing. But because we'd come in, they'd changed it to the Steelers game, so this poor fella had to leave. And he was actually from Wisconsin as well.
Sweeter, really.
Yeah, it would have been. We met a Ravens fan who hung out with us, a Scottish Ravens fan, who was
okay.
In the
sleeping with the enemy.
Gear. Yeah, we met a young lady who was from Pittsburgh and was completely bewildered at the fact that there was a group of men from the UK who had, most of which had never been to Pittsburgh. I think it had only me that had ever been, that were all here supporting her team. it was a good time. There was a lot of sort of interesting people in there, people with all supporting all different teams. I thought we got some stick offs and Patriots fans, obviously. I think we want to do another one. Obviously, we'll probably do it further down south and I'll drive down, but hopefully you can make the next one, Gav.
Oh, that'd be good. Did Jason bring up Rod Woodson at all?
Not to me.
All right, because I know he's a big fan of his. I wondered if he just brought, you know, every opportunity he wanted to talk about him. But no, okay, good. Good on you, Jason.
Jason, what a gent. Obviously set the group up, for, you know, been running it for years, and a great guy, and glad we finally got to meet him as well. So yeah, anyone you know listening, I'm sure for the next one we'll probably open it up a bit if we go somewhere a bit bigger. So anyone listening who wants to tag along, please do. There was a few people who hit me up afterwards who said, "Oh, you know, I wish I'd known about this. You know, I'm not on the Facebook group or what have you." So next time, if it's a little bit more open, we'll try and mention it on the podcast to make sure everyone knows about it. But yeah, great fun. Cool. Anything else big that you want to go over, guys? Anything you want to hit before we get out of here?
Do we have time for subjects, or is that going to be completely up to
you? I know some of you are on tight schedules with kids and whatnot, but we can hit. I haven't got anything major. I'll save mine for next week. I got a question in from the audience, but I will save it for next week. So, but Dave, you can hit one if you want.
I mean, Gav kind of brought it up a little bit before. With Ben out, it felt like the offense was sort of flowing a lot better. That things were moving a lot better. Does this highlight? I mean, it did to me. I might be wrong. Does this highlight how much influence Ben had on play calling that Randy had almost no influence?
It's an interesting question. I think obviously, it's going to be different when Mason comes in, because when you've got a guy coming in like that, especially at halftime, you're going to go to him and sort of say, you know, what plays are you comfortable with? What areas of the playbook, you know, do you know well, and can we really focus on and do kind of what he's comfortable with and what he likes? So I think in that sense, there's maybe not a lot to take away from what we saw from Mason. But we are going to see a big change, because obviously Mason's not going to be in the same position. He's not going to be able to be calling his own plays and doing that kind of thing, at least for this season. So, Gavin?
Well, they said that he was completely prepared, and they didn't lose any of the playbook at all when he came in.
Well,
which I think is great. You know, they've got confidence in him, Mason, and I do think I did sort of mention it before. I think Ben has been, as much as you have to kind of have an identity, and Ben's brought that identity with his play style, but then that's limited what the play calling can be. So it's not a predictability, but certainly teams can work out how to stop Ben, I think, especially like the Patriots, obviously. So maybe this shifting sands with having a more open tactical playbook, I think it'll be an exciting time. So I think you're right, Dave.
I think maybe Ben had, not say too much, maybe a bit too much control over what was going on. Like you say, I think teams have maybe cottoned on to what his general, you know, just predicting him. So yeah, I think it was time to, not that I'm saying that Ben's out altogether now and this is the end of it, I think it was maybe time to move away from Ben playing the calls quite, you know, calling the plays quite so much, really.
Go on, Dave.
I was going to say, I quite like Todd Haley's play call. I know he was a bit of a diddlo with his getting drunk and beating people up in bars and all that other antics he was getting up to. But some of his play calling, I mean, his use of the trips and the screens and all that stuff, and I don't know, I thought, but obviously Ben didn't like it, he didn't want to do it anymore, which is why he was kind of instrumental in getting rid of him and putting Fichtner in, right?
Yeah, and also, you know, we had AB, we had Lev Bell, that was a different time.
True.
So it's hard to compare these things, I think, and I think Ben having that level of understanding of the offense is only a good thing. I get the point that you're trying to make, Dave, that you know, there's a point where the quarterback has a bit too much control. But
doesn't hurt Brady, does it?
Exactly, yeah. And Ben's a different character to Brady, so again, it's hard to compare. But I do think that when you've got a guy like that who can, you know, even just make reads at the line of scrimmage and change things pre-snap and do things like that, it is a benefit. And I would rather have that, even if, you know, he gets to chew up a couple of his own plays that he fancies now and then over, you know, a rookie quarterback. But Mason's a smart guy, you know. I think he will pick it up, and I think we'll get there. And, you know, it's not like Kansas or, you know, Philadelphia had any trouble when Carson and Patrick Mahomes stepped in. So,
well, if it goes as well as either of those situations, you'll be laughing.
Well, we can only dream that it goes as well as... do you ever think about that? I'll tell you what, that can be my topic, actually, before we go, really quickly. Do you ever think about that draft? With the Steelers, because I remember, I know it's every team says this now, because, you know, almost anyone could have drafted him, but I remember pre-draft process, Patrick Mahomes was kind of viewed as a second round prospect almost. He was kind of the fifth or sixth guy people were talking about, and then, you know, people got higher and higher on him, and he flew up the draft boards. But all that time, the Steelers were talked about as a team that was really interested in him.
Yeah.
And I think if he had not maybe had that hype level around him pre-draft and he'd have stayed at that kind of late first, low second round grade, we might have ended up with him. So
yeah, it's true. Yeah. He's one of those draft prospects that got hot and then cooled a little bit.
Yeah.
It's kind of a weird trajectory. And then it was almost quite a surprise when the Chiefs took him.
Yeah, so high, yeah. And traded up for him, I think. But I think so many quarterbacks had gone and they needed one, so... But yeah, I do always think about what could have been with...
Well, it's like that with George Kittle as well, because the Steelers drafted Josh Dobbs instead of George Kittle.
Yeah.
Well, on that note, well, I'm glad we've come full, I'm glad we've come full circle from, you know, depression to optimism to depression again. But this has been the Self-Pity Podcast. I think we've been pretty optimistic this week, to be fair, guys. So well done. Pat yourselves on the back. And thank you so much for joining me. Obviously, this is a, I say it every week, this is a First and Ten podcast brought to you by First and Ten. The network is growing at an almost an alarming rate. We've got a Saints podcast, a Cowboys podcast, a Jags podcast, a Raiders podcast. So as always, if you've got any interest in any of those teams, or you've got friends, family, please let them know about First and Ten and get them to check out the relevant podcast, or get in touch with those guys if you want to get involved. Lovely. Thanks so much for joining me again this week, guys.
Cheers, guys.
Cheers.
Thanks.
Goodbye.
See ya.
Bye.